third session. We had two sessions this morning, and this is the third session for the Business Forum at the second Global Peace Economic Forum 2017. But before we start, we'd like to ask those at the back to please come forward. Kindly disregard the nameplates or the labels on each table. We'd like to get everybody involved as much as possible, so feel free to come forward so you can enjoy the presentations of our speakers much more from up front. So this afternoon, we shall be discussing trade and investment as a catalyst for peace and regional stability. And we have with us, again, very distinguished speakers to share their knowledge and their wisdom with us. And after their presentations, we shall be having a very short Q&A forum. So feel free to ask your questions after. But before that, we'd like to acknowledge the presence of several distinguished guests in the audience. First, we'd like to acknowledge the presence of DOJ Secretary Vidaliano Aguirre, who's here with us today. Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, Undersecretary Attorney Nabil A. Tan. Good afternoon. Former COMELEC Chairman Sixto Brillantes is also with us today. And former NBI Director Magtanggol Gadula. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for joining us. Well, so as we said earlier, we're discussing trade and investment as a catalyst for peace and regional stability. And our first speaker is the former DTI Undersecretary and Chamber Vice President and former Chairman and President of the Chamber of Commerce of the Philippine Islands. He was formerly Associate Professor of the University of the Philippines and Director of the UP Institute of Small Scale Industries. Managing Head of the Board of Investment and Governor of the BOI. He's also a recipient of international and national awards, including the Honor Award from the World Association of Small and Medium Enterprises, the Tory Award for Courage, the UPAA Achievement Award for Management, and the LaSalle Award. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Melito Salazar Jr.
Thank you very much. I also will be moderating the session later, so my presentation is kind of an overview just to give some points that might be considered in the course of our discussions today. Let me begin by saying that poverty is the greatest obstacle to peace. In whatever region we are, in whatever country we are, when there is poverty, there will always be conflict that comes about. So peace is something we all desire for ourselves, for our family, for our nation, and for the regions that we exist in. We can eradicate poverty in many ways. Education comes in, social services, infrastructure, but more importantly, jobs, job creation, income generation is the one that is going to help us eradicate poverty. And when we look at investments coming into the country, the investors look at these variables, wage rate, labor skills, tax rates, and so on, political stability. In a way, investors begin to understand the country that they are going into. That understanding, as we show later, obviously leads to peace. Because foreign investments come in, they see around them, they listen to people, both at the national and local levels, and then they understand the situation. And you and I know that the beginning of peace is in understanding each other. But investments are more than just jobs. When people come in, put in their funds, they really also result in providing training for the workforce. They bring in the values of teamwork, the values of collaboration, and the bringing about of a greater sense of community. All of this are strong pillars for peace. as different investors from different countries come in, they begin to understand the culture of each other. So they come from all over the world, but in the end, they converge in the workplace, in business associations, and that convergence leads to understanding and a better appreciation of each other. Understanding also is understanding individuals within the organization. And of course, in the world of global business, we now see that you can take a snapshot of an organization and it will be multicolored, because organizations today come from many nationalities, are staffed by people from many cultures. Trade, on the other hand, means trade in goods, trades in services. Interestingly enough, when we look at a product that is being sold in a country, that product gives us a better understanding of the culture that led to the production of that product. When you say that that is a Japanese-made product, when you say that's a Chinese-made product, immediately in your mind, there is the message of what that product signifies in terms of the creativity, in terms of the industry, in terms of the design that goes into the product. In the trade in services, we see the human face. That means that as someone provides you a service and that person comes from another country, the face-to-face contact gives you, again, a vivid picture of the culture of that particular country. And so, when you do all of this, investment and trade, there is a whole mix of marketing mix, production mix, all of these taken together. What therefore happens? Well, the businessmen who are part of this paradigm begin to understand each other, and understanding each other leads not only to peace, but to collaboration. The consumers, the citizens of the different countries, as they are exposed to, again, the products and services, they too will have a better understanding of the culture, the country, and the people. And so, if we look at trade and investment, therefore, as a catalyst for peace and regional stability, we can say that it is principally because, number one, trade and investment leads to the creation of jobs, which alleviates poverty. And as I said in the beginning, poverty is the greatest obstacle to peace. But the second point is that trade and investment brings people together. And as they come together, they understand each other, they're able to work with each other, they're able to collaborate rather than compete, and that leads to peace. And so, my friends, I think all of us here should commit ourselves to continue to create an environment that is conducive to investments, whether local or foreign, as well as an environment that energizes trade among countries, between countries, so that in the end, we truly will have peace as well as regional stability. Thank you.
Hey. Thank you very much, former Undersecretary Salazar. I think that really is a message that hits close to home, that poverty is the greatest obstacle to peace, especially now when we are, you know, in the process of trying to achieve peace in different regions in our country, and especially also something that hopefully will translate into the international community and with our neighbors. Thank you so much, former Undersecretary Salazar. At this point, we would like to call on our next speaker, to also discuss trade and investment as a catalyst for peace and regional stability. He's the CEO of the Center for China and Globalization and chairman of the Chinese Abroad Chamber of Commerce and founder and president of the Center for China and Globalization, which is a top social think tank in China, and director of CCG's One Belt, One Road Research Institute. He serves as vice chairman of the China Association for International Economic Cooperation, the Association of the Ministry of Commerce, and the China Western Overseas Return Scholars Association. He was a senior fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School and has published over 50 books and numerous articles on China and globalization. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Huiyao Wang.
Thank you for the kind introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and also distinguished panelists. It's really a great opportunity to be here at this a great forum, and thank organizer for the invitation. I would like to, the topic I'm actually to talk about today is the role of investment in building a new strategic partnership. I think that the theme of this topic is of this section is really excellent: trade and investment, and as a catalyst for the peace and stability. So what I'm going to cover is in the next little while is about how investment is transforming China and the region as well. So we can see that, you know, what we can do in the future for strengthening this kind of cooperation. The overall picture of Chinese enterprise going global, I would like to discuss about that. And this is really, we see a enormous growth in the last number of years, and also Chinese investment trend going around the world. And I would like to also talk about China-ASEAN cooperation, since we are having this conference in Philippines, and which is part of the ASEAN as well. And finally, I would like to give some recommendation to the China-ASEAN cooperation. As a matter of fact, the Center for China and Globalization has been the largest independent think tank in China. Yeah, we have about over 100 full-time researchers and staff, and has been ranked actually in the last 2 years by the University of Pennsylvania Think Tank Center as the number one independent think tank in China. We publish annually the China Blue Books on investment overseas. So I would like to give you some summary of the latest book we published, that we can see three highlights of that. First is China has become the net export for the first time since 2016, 2015. So China now, which means that if the foreign investment coming to China is smaller than the Chinese investment going overseas now. That's number one. And number two, and China, of course, has bypassed Japan as the second largest direct investment source in the world after the US. And thirdly, China's investment to the U.S. is also larger now than the U.S. investment to China. So you can see these enormous happening, a lot of changes has been happening in the last number of years. Of course, we can see that, for example, in 1915, China overseas investment has reached $140 billion, and last year has reached $170 billion U.S. dollars. And there was other estimate by other investment research institutes that could be over $200 billion. So this is really a big investment overseas. And of course, China is used to be behind Japan in terms of foreign investment. Now it's also more than Japan in terms of investment overseas. And one of the things I think quite interesting now is, as Donald Trump has been saying, that to make America great again and attract investment to the U.S., as a matter of fact, there's more, a lot more Chinese companies are investing in the U.S. For example, the Huiyao glass, the auto glass maker, the largest one in the world, has just invested $1 billion and has built three plants in the U.S. One of them was in Ohio, and which is the state-of-the-art investment in the U.S. and of the auto glass manufacturing, which employs over 3,000 local jobs. So you see, this kind of a collaboration of China investment in the U.S. could be a promotion, could be a stability for the Sino-U.S. relations. The trend of Chinese enterprise going global is quite alarming. Of course, you can see the steep growth like that. Of course, in the last year is even more. There's another 30-40 increase compared with 2015. And this is the number just up to 2015. So we will see more enterprises going global in China. In terms of the region preference of China investment overseas, our think tank has done a survey among the Chinese manufacturers, and also we compile data to do some analysis on that. You can see Asia is still quite heavy in terms of China investment overseas, and Europe is another one, and North America and Africa. So basically, in all parts of the world. And of course, in terms of the sectors of the Chinese investment, as I just mentioned, the manufacturing, actually China is starting to go in global. We used to see a lot of foreign companies come to China to do the manufacturing, but now Chinese companies are starting to invest more overseas. As I mentioned, that China automaker, auto glass makers just invest $1 billion in the U.S. Just a good example of that. There's many companies like that. So we see the Chinese manufacturing graduating and then starting to move their manufacturing base to other parts of the world. And also in terms of the mold, we see a lot of merger acquisition, cross-border acquisitions. That has been a main model of Chinese investment as well. The outbound investment of Chinese, movement used to be Chinese state-owned enterprises play a lot of role, SOE. But now you see the majority of the investment now is private enterprises. So the private enterprises now plays more roles of Chinese investment overseas, and then there's a sharp increase of that, which is also quite interesting to look at that. And also, Chinese small and medium enterprises also starting to increase. Just give you an example. For example, if you talk about the investor immigrants to the U.S. EB-5 visas, the U.S. issue about 10,000 visas a year on the investment visa, and the 9,000 of them were grabbed by the Chinese. So 90% of the EB-5 investments were from China, which a lot of are small and medium enterprises. Now, the globalization is starting to take in new terms, particularly of this current new government of China. Now, the President Xi has actually announced One by One Road initiative, which regarded as a new initiative from China in terms of expand the globalization or enlarge the globalization scope, which they have a lot of elements to that. I'm not going to go all the details, but basically covers if you want to make One by One Road Initiative successful, there's five elements of that. There should be a people-to-people bonds. There should be the trade. There should be policy coordination, facility connecting, and financial integration. That's why China also set up a AIIB, Asian Investment Infrastructure Bank. So that's a good examples of OBOR. And so the One by One Road Initiative actually is very, very grand in terms of its scope. It covers about 65 countries, and it's expanded through Southeast Asia on the Silk Road, Maritime Silk Road, but also it covers the land of the Silk Road through Central Asia to Europe. So it's a very ambitious plan, but I think if it works together with all the countries, and if it's beneficial to all the countries, that should be a very good project to work for. Now I'm going to talk a bit about the China-ASEAN cooperation, and I think China and ASEAN are both among each other the largest trading partners. I think that the strong cooperation between China-ASEAN countries, particularly the trade and investment, will contribute to the growth, to the peace and stability, and that's really the key. I think after the Second World War, we see the major the peacetime of today is that the world is really relatively without a major conflict is because the precisely because of the trade and investment among the world countries. So if we continue that, I think it would be really good. So China has actually been very active in terms of doing have treaties, have cooperation mechanism, you know, 10+1, 10+3, 10+6, and is actively participating. And also the trade between for example, China-ASEAN trade has also increased quite significantly in the last number of years, with annual growth of 18%, which is enormous growth. So China is also too active to is the largest trading partner to many ASEAN countries as well, and also investment as well. And we can see China also, for that purpose, has formed the Broad Forum Asia, and that's really attaches great importance to ASEAN countries. And also, they have built high-level dialogues and partnerships. And there's in China, there's ASEAN Expo. There's a variety of mechanisms to do that. The final thing I would like to touch a bit about the suggestions for the China-ASEAN partnership, because I think this region is really important. You know, in Southeast Asia, in China, particularly with all those countries, we have a lot of a mechanism in discussing. But I think we need to really move on to some more stable and carry out some new mechanism to enhance the trade and the stability, particularly among the BITs and also FTA, trade investment. For example, China joined WTO, and then it's a really, the globalization has made China one of the most active trading partners in the world. And I think that if we have more global trade mechanism, that will help as well. So cross-border e-commerce is also very, very, very good way of doing that. China now, for example, out of the 10 largest internet companies, China accounts 4 to 5 of them. And of course, you know that Alibaba is the largest e-trading company in the world. And then e-commerce, it's also flourishing in China. And I hope that can bring new impetus to the ASEAN region by strengthening the e-commerce collaboration. And also we talk about Donald Trump creates a TPP in the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but I think that's actually there's a lot of countries are inviting China to participate. China is also actively involved on RCEP discussions. So I think the ASEAN and China should quickly really form a new trade mechanism in terms of the governance, the promoting the trade among the region, particularly for the Asia Pacific. And one of the idea actually China actually suggested, but also was one of the earliest idea promoted by APEC, by US and China in a long time ago, was FTAAP, Free Trade Agreement. Between China and Asia Pacific. So FTAAP actually covers both RCEP and TPP countries, and that would be a very good way to do that in the future. We actually, CCG has I've done a lot of report on that. We actually released a report. We were saying that FTAAP would be a good mechanism after TPP, in the post-EPP TPP era. So there's many ways to do that. I'll be given the time, I'm not going to say that, but there's many pros and cons in large RCEP, in large TPP, combine RCEP and TPP and FTAAP and things like that. So there's many ways to tackle that. As a matter of fact, based on the Peterson Institute studies, that FTAP can generate more outcome for either TPP or RCEP. So it could be a good idea to combine both for the region. And so I think this is really the way that we should continue to discuss and to really make things happen in this region. And there's many ways to do that, and in strengthening the frame of negotiation, collaboration would be the way to go. And also using a network of Chinese, diaspora Chinese overseas, which is very rich in the Southeast Asian countries. And also there's many other areas to collaborate. Because of the time, I'm not going to cover that. And finally, for CCG, the Center for China Globalization, we are, as I said, the largest independent think tank in China. We have offices in Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, and Qingdao, and Shenzhen, and also quite a number of representatives overseas. So we hope to expand our collaboration with ASEAN countries and to cover the issues in ASEAN. And we published most of the blue books on the trade, talents, company going global, investment, and things like that. And also we do the English publication as well. One of the books we talk about China Goes Global is just published last year. So I really, really enjoy this conference, and I thank all of you for the attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wang, and for sharing with us how China has gone global. It's also interesting to see how you mentioned how there's an increase in the small and medium-scale enterprises in China, which is also what we're trying to adapt here in our country to try and build the SMEs in the Philippines so that we can also open more doors of opportunity for our countrymen here today. So thank you so much, Dr. Wang. At this point, we'd like to call on our next speaker. He's the president, chairman, and CEO of the AMT Group of Companies with interests in petroleum and shipping, among others. Governor Tan served as a congressman for the 1st District of Sulu and thereafter as governor and vice governor of the same province. He united the heirs to the Sulu Sultanate, and on November 29, 2016, he was granted authority to represent the 5 sultans in all matters and concerns relative to the Sultanate and was conferred the royal rank of Datu Shabandar and appointed special envoy of the council. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Governor Abdusakur Mahail Tan.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Other speakers, guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Actually, I was very hesitant when I got invited to speak before this kind of forum. This is my first ever to speak before a forum such as this. You know, Olivia here, Distilleria Limtuaco, persuaded me to speak today. She told me that this would be a very good forum, considering that there is a wrong perception about your province, Sulu. So I thought I would give it the chance for my province. Now let me speak about Sulu. Next. Sulu was established a century ago in 1917. It is located in the southern Philippines. It is one of the component provinces of the ARMM with 2 congressional districts. It has 410 barangays. It is a second-class province with 824,000 population and 167,000 hectares of land area. It has always been depicted as a war-torn area. But Sulu is so beautiful. with its pristine white beaches. And look at the islands, look at the colors. I must show some images, because they say that these images are more truthful than perhaps of what I would say. We are likewise very rich in culture. Look at the performing arts, our weaving, our musical instruments. You should see our dancers. You know, civilization in the Philippines started in Sulu. That was way, way back. Next. We are very rich in agriculture and aquamarine resources. Our major crops are coconut, cassava, abaca, coffee, native mangoes, and exotic fruits like durian, mangosteen, and lansonism. We are also growing seaweeds, and we do fishing as among our major industries. Sulu contributes 40% of the total Philippine export of carrageenan. But not so many know that we have so much to offer. Sulu has one airport. We have three seaports. And the Philippine Airlines is resuming flights to Sulu in the middle of this year, sometime in June or July. We have five banking institutions. But, you know, the poverty incidents, Mr. Melito, Salazar, I do agree with you. The poverty incidence is so high at 61.8%, way, way above the national average of 20%. Next. We are a people who take pride in our heritage. We value our freedom and appreciate peace and harmony. But perhaps we only have freedom of movements. Our people are hungry for freedom from illiteracy and sickness. You know, this is, I mean, human nature. You can build castles, they say. You can build bridges. But in the end, people will always ask for freedom. Now, the Sultanate of Sulu is a Muslim state that in the past ruled the islands in the Sulu archipelago, parts of Mindanao, certain portions of Palawan, and northeastern Borneo. Sulu was a regional entry port. It was not a back door, it was a front door. In fact, we were trading even long before the Philippines became a country. We were already trading with China. We were already trading with India. We were already trading with Arabia. Recently, I was able to bring the five royal houses of Sulu together. They signed the covenant. And made me, or conferred on me, a royal title of Dato as their special envoy. And very soon, I would like to invite them to come to China. For in fact, I already sought an appointment with the ambassador, the Chinese ambassador to the Philippines, and this is going to take place, inshallah, God willing, on Friday. I want to invite the five sultans, together with the entourage, to come to China and visit the tomb of the Sultan of Sulu, who was invited by the then Emperor of Cathay, when mainland China was still known then as Katay. This was in the year 1417. That was 600 years ago. So we want to visit the tomb of the Sultan of Sulu, the only monarch buried in Chinese soil. Next. Is economic development is economic development hampered by instability, unrest, and long-running separatist insurgency? I would say it is the other way around. In the past administrations, the same sentiment was shared by people from all over Mindanao, not only in Sulu, but also in Mindanao. We were forgotten, we were neglected, and I would like to believe this brought about to the unrest in the South. Next. Now, the government, the Philippine government, has been talking to several fronts, or at least to two fronts in the South, to the Moro National Liberation Front and to the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and came up with a solution of organizing the ARMM, the Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. But to me, the autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao is not the answer. In fact, no less than the president, the former president of the Philippines, President Aquino, who dubbed this as a failed experiment. Although, in the last elections, President Aquino proceeded to fully support candidates who have been governing in the ARMM. For what reasons? I really do not know. There must be millions, billions of reasons behind this. Now, that is why I have been wanting to get out of the ARMM. Why do I want to get out of the ARMM? We are being subsidized by the national government. So do you call this autonomous? We can never be autonomous for as long as we are not self-sufficient. Look at the provinces outside of the ARMM. They are more prosperous than those in the ARMM. The poverty incidence, despite the amount of funds provided by previous administrations to the ARMM, the poverty incidence continues to go up. It has never gone down. In fact, ARMM is the poorest region in the whole country. Next. But there is a better alternative. The better alternative is federalism. I would say it is a better alternative because this would free us from the ARMM. They will have to amend the constitution, and this would allow the territorial configuration to change. Just yesterday, I was with the president, and I told the president about it. I told the president that it is not, perhaps, that may not be good for the Muslim provinces or the poor provinces or the impoverished provinces to be lumped together. We want to be assimilated into the mainstream. We do not want to be isolated and be confined to just one corner. We want to be a part of the whole country. Next. Now, in local governance, I have been a governor. Actually, I'm no longer the governor. It is my son who is the governor. We are trying as much as possible to make local governance very participative. We always invite the civil society organizations, the business sector, the academe, the religious, and the security sectors. So, this is how we are doing it. Since we can hardly go to the regional government, which is highly centralized. Next. Now, entrepreneurs and investors as game changers. The big business, the investors, the entrepreneurs, you are the answer to our problem. You can help alleviate poverty because big business, the resources of big business is boundless. Unlike government, they change leadership, they change policies, they change programs. So, we have so much to offer. We have copra in fisheries and in agriculture. That's why we'd like to invite our entrepreneurs to come to Sulu and see for yourselves how we live there. Next. In fact, we are glad that we now have a president who comes from Sulu. From Mindanao. Never did we have any president who was from Mindanao. It is only President Duterte. And recently, he invited big business to come together in Malacanang. That was on December 19. And he dubbed this as the town hall event. Invited big business like San Miguel, the MVP group, the group of Lusiotan, the group of Gokongwei, Distilleria Limtuaco, Schumart, and so many others. And recently, we launched their pledges and commitment in Sulu. In Sulu, they were there, and they saw how we live there. We are very, very thankful to this big business who are providing school buildings, providing a livelihood, and putting up business, including power. MBP has committed to put up a coal-fueled power plant of 50 megawatt. Next. Now, we have possible areas of investment. We can invest in telecommunications, in food technology, food processing, seaports, even airport, and of course, power. Next. You know, it is only a matter of perception, as I said earlier. There was a friend of mine when I was doing trading many, many years back, an Indian friend of mine who would always tell me, "Sakur, it is always good to fish in troubled waters. That is if you take risks." And I know businessmen, big business always take risks. They dare to venture into the uncharted waters. So may I invite you to come and visit and dare to tread the uncharted waters of the Sulu Sea. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Governor Tan. What a privilege to be part of the audience for your first ever presentation or speech in such a forum. We all look forward to the growth and progress of Sulu and share in that hope for lasting peace in Sulu. Thank you so much, Governor Tan. At this point, we are now on our last speaker for this particular session. Our next speaker started his career as an investment analyst, and he went on to practice law at his own law firm. And in 2004, he joined the Malaysian government as political secretary at the Prime Minister's Department. He spent a decade in government at various senior positions at the Economic Spending or Economic Planning Unit, the Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Defense, and Ministry of Finance. He's also involved in many NGOs in Malaysia, including the National Red Crescent Organization, the Asian Football Confederation, and founding president of Esports Malaysia, which is the governing national body for electronic sports. Latt Shariman Abdullah received his education at the Mara University of Technology Malaysia in public policy, and he continued to study law at the International Islamic University before pursuing further studies at Stanford University and Cambridge University. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dato Latt Shariman Abdullah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon. Thank you, Ms. Chairman, for the kind introduction. Distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very embarrassed, but I have to tell you that this is my first visit to Manila, although I have many, many good Filipino friends. I would like to speak to you in the spirit of one of my most admired leaders now, which is President Duterte, which is to celebrate Tapang at Malasakit. Is that correct? For John, who doesn't know Tagalog, it means courage and care. Ladies and gentlemen, trade and investment as a catalyst for peace and regional stability, please allow me to speak in simple terms. 400 years ago, such statement would have been considered absurd at worst and a propaganda at best. It was absurd because there were really no trade as we understand it today. There were some exchanges, yes, but mostly on inequitable terms that were shadowed by threats of violence by stronger countries against weaker ones. It was a propaganda because it was used to mask one-sided exchanges. The arrangement was obvious. If you do not agree to the consideration, I will just rob it of you. The reason for rudimentary compensation of the exchange were only to encourage the weaker to keep the charade going on. It was only when threats of violence were not conveniently feasible that some measure of consensus in the exchanges occurred. Hence, big time trade expositions were always accompanied by military hardware. So understandably, trade and war became inextricably linked. But trade was not the term we use as we understand it today. So to discuss it as if it is futile. Today, the world is a global village, which automatically removes the previous understanding of the meaning of that word. If I don't want to sell to you, I am as free to sell to the other guy. Free and consensual, as best as it can possibly be. Not the free trade that we used to go to war for, not the favored nation status that we fought for ourselves. In fact, violent arm twisting is counterproductive in the present scenario. So it is in that context that the topic of our discussion becomes relevant. So if one strong country takes over some unpopulated islands, barely hiding behind the maxim that might is right, only for the purposes of owning whatever there are under those islands, and not negotiating with the competing claims, nor interacting with any of the natives, because there are none, you can bet that that area would be plagued by tensions and instability no matter how strong you are. And that is the reality today. That's the beautiful thing about trade. There is now a platform to negotiate to reach a lasting, comfortable mercantile relationship you can't negotiate with a gunboat. So nowadays, trade pacts are the order of the day, not treaties like regional defense and the like. It is heartening to note that efforts are being made to establish stronger relationships between these countries, in my country, Malaysia, even here in the Philippines. Efforts are being made to assure each other of continuing commitments by using investments, to assure each other of commitments in each other's future. This forebodes well for peace and stability. On the other hand, there is someone who believes that trade agreements are indirectly dangerous things. They so-called rob the countries of jobs, and they allow unfettered mixing of minnows and with giants, so he wants to be wolves and restrict travel to be made great again. How a powerful country had supposedly negotiated itself into this supposed hole beats me. Already, Mexico is threatening tariffs, a trade restriction if the wall is built. So where do you sell your stuff? They can buy elsewhere. The global village allows for that. So let's see if able-bodied white Americans will be picking berries next few summers, or the Chinese, in support of his newfound friends, continue to buy your wheat and soybean. Trade is what makes the world go round. It is no longer mercantile adventurism of centuries old. It can empower weaker countries to stand up and be counted. What I mean to point out is, trade is now a tool in search of a win-win agreement. It may not be the answer to global peace, but it is definitely a catalyst to do that, to the end. Why? For the simple reasons that equitable trade in the form that it has to be today, as close as possible, brings prosperity for the participants. And trade can only flourish in a stable environment, and it follows that it is definitely a catalyst for the creation of lasting peace. The geopolitics of today is imperatively trade politics. Without the gunboats, the Trans-Pacific Partnership is one such first facilitation. Any isolationist that choose to view such arrangements as restrictive is actually a suspect for unilateral power player. Such an ego-blasting seeker is anti-trade and as such, anti-peace. A catalyst for peace presupposes that it is a tool for peace. A relevant example is that intra-regional peace can be achieved by using trade as a tool. Say, for example, if the perceived persecution of Rohingyas in Myanmar is threatening regional stability because of the spillover of refugees to Malaysia, efforts to persuade Myanmar towards action towards a solution for the internal Rohingya problem can be embodied in trade. For example, the human trade services trade that allows Myanmar to export its workers to my country could be threatened to be called off. While there are other countries from which Malaysia can get its workers, Malaysia is about the only country Myanmar sends its workers to. The devastating effect to Myanmar's economy may compel it to act as an internal issue. Restricting trade is not an act for revenge in this case, because Malaysia is not inherently attached to the problem. It is a kind of trade sanction, but it's a convenient non-violent tool to coerce regional stability and peace without the need for military enforcement, unlike other kinds of sanctions. Hinterland trade among intra-regional countries keep their population interacting with each other. Intra-regional trade offset the tensions that may occur as a result of close proximity. So it is important, if your country is a backyard of a superpower, it is important that that superpower facilitate increased trade with it. It makes good geopolitical sense, unlike wars that alienate. So if centuries ago, It is trade that were the reason to provoke war. Today, because internal relations are such, it is conversely the tool for peace. Trade sanction is one way to abuse it, but it is admitted that unilateral sanction in a multipolar world that we are coming to would be difficult to enforce. Trade and investment allows for reciprocity, and it may be that balance that may stop the boat from rocking. Maraming salamat. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dato Shariman Abdullah, for reminding us that we do live in a global village and that we have tools in our hands to make sure that we can be ourselves part of that catalyst for change and peace and stability in our world. Thank you so much. And thank you so much to all our speakers for sharing your time with us and speaking before us today. Former Yusek Salazar will open the floor for questions and moderate the rest of the discussion for those who wish to ask any questions. Please feel free to use the microphones to push forth your questions.
Well, thank you very much. We had very good presentations. Unfortunately, Dr. Huang had to leave, but I can take his place, actually, simply because I've been quite in touch with our friends in China. When I was the Undersecretary of Trade and Industry, I was the one who negotiated the trade protocol with Madam Wu Yi, who was then the Minister of International Trade. I've been going to China frequently. My last visit, actually, was upon the invitation of the Communist Party of China, where we had very good discussions on both trade, investments, and security issues. So I told Dr. Wang, don't worry, you can leave. I will give the Chinese perspective from a Filipino view. Okay. So we had very interesting presentations. We have seen, we have Sulu, we have an area ripe for investment, and the good governor has shown that it would be better when trade and investments is the one that propels growth in the area and the alleviation of poverty. Our good friend from Malaysia has indicated to us that maybe it's really trade politics now that rules the world, so to speak, and therefore, if we do it properly, it can lead to peace. We are now open for any questions. There are mics situated in the room. Kindly just come forward, state your name, state your questions, and let's keep it concise and precise so that others can also ask their own questions. Yes, please, the gentleman over there.
Good afternoon, sir. Your humble person was able to contribute some effort to the development of trade with China. I was recruited during the time after we have established diplomatic relation with China after the long time of restriction. It was after the opening of diplomatic relation with China, then a certain government corporation was established. It was the Philippine International Trading Corporation, and Mr. Rul was the vice president during that time. And your humble person was then sent to China as trade representative of International Trading Corporation and also accredited as trade attaché. We were able to export during that time large shipment of coconut oil from Davao, the Gaspi oil, and then copper concentrate from Toledo, Cebu. And this was the opening of our trade and the economic development with China during that time. That was in the 70s. And the thing I would like to say that we have also invited two big Chinese corporations which is the Steel and Iron Corporation of China, to put up, assist the local mall development, which is the Grand Central Mall in the Philippines, in the Caloocan area. It was very successful during that time. And the next investment was in non-ferrous cyanide Import-Export Corporation. They put up some, what we call, real estate development in the Philippines. Afterwards, I hope that we should have a continue this kind of a very basic economic development between Philippines and China. And I found out that after this airport, the government-to-government relationship was not so, freely, so that we can put up more investment from China. And we should need people who are knowledgeable and who understand the beneficial effect between our two countries.
Thank you
very much. I am Rogelio Espanyo from Bicol and also from Manila. I study Chinese and also speak right fluent Chinese. Thank you
very much for enlightening us that there is a foundation already of partnership between China and the Philippines. And of course, in the current environment, we hope that more investments and trade will come in. Incidentally, in my last visit to Beijing, I had discussions. At the time, of course, there was still tension. But one of the things that the Chinese authorities informed me was that they have a very big industrial estate in Malaysia that is exclusively for Chinese companies going to Malaysia. And it was something that they said that they would want to do and put up also in the Philippines if they have an opportunity. I don't know if Tan Sri would like to say something about Chinese investments in Malaysia.
Well, Malaysia is one of the first countries that established diplomatic ties with China in 1973 or maybe 74. And from then on, we have been like almost the Guantanamo of United States. A lot of investments from China has come in, even during the communist times. And it's no surprise why Malaysia and Chinese relationship has been very good for a long, long time. Yeah, you mentioned about the city, it is called the Forest City in south of the peninsula, where the Chinese are able to come and live there for freehold land for as long as they want. It's almost like China, but in Malaysia, it's true. It's called Forest City, which is very, Dr. Mahathir, former Prime Minister, is very against now.
Really? Okay. By the way, I used to lecture when he was Prime Minister in Noordin Salim. Noordin, yes. I call him my Malaysian cousin because we are similar. Yes, I know. Regretfully, he has passed on. Are there any other questions comments? Yes, please. I see the gentleman over there. Please come forward. Just state your name and either your comment or any of us would be happy to respond to your inquiry.
My only question to this forum is regarding the new models for peace and development, which is the objective. It seems to me that the statement, the gentleman from Malaysia, tells about the truth that there were trade before, but it was under duress. There was military threat. And the statement of the governor says that before the Spaniards came, there were trade already, but there was no mention of the military threat. And the Chinese here came up with a statement that there will be one road, one belt. But the problem is, there's a problem with Spratly. Come up with a model like trade and investment would be the road for peace. Now my question is, what model shall we follow now that we have those present circumstances right now? That's all.
Okay, that's a very provocative and interesting question. I will start with our friend from Malaysia. And then also there might be those of you in the audience who would like to give your views on, you know, the problem with models sometimes is there's no one size that fits all. So, but maybe, and then afterwards, Governor.
Thank you for that question. I mentioned it a bit in my speech just now, and I believe China has been going on the right path now. Before, as I mentioned, they were there without regard to the other countries that are claiming those part of islands. But now that we are sitting down, the Philippines are sitting down together with the Chinese on other parts of the trade. That means there's already a negotiation going on. I'm sure those kind of investments in the Philippines will attribute to some sort of negotiation, a kinder, a gentler deal towards Spratlys. Yeah, because I know that China wants to be your friend. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, you know, we were trading with China. That is our history tells us that way, way back, we were already trading with China, but in fact, the Sultan of Sulu was invited by the Emperor of China, and he died there. That was 600 years ago today, or to this year. And, you know, there is that policy of former Prime Minister Mahathir, which is prosper thy neighbor. That prosper thy neighbor policy, if that is, I mean, truly implemented, I would think that would discourage intrusions among neighbors. And now when the Spaniards came to colonize the Philippines, we put up resistance. That is why they came to the north. We were left out. Several administrations came in, the Americans came in, the Japanese, and then the Philippine government. We felt we were neglected. So while we were doing the trading in the past, we became the back door. Now they call us back door, but we were front door. We were an economic emporium. Civilization started in our area. And we are looking to trade and investment. We are looking to economic development to be the answer to our problem in the South. The problem in the South is the problem of the entire country. Not only the problem of the entire country, it is the problem of the whole region, the Southeast Asia region. You must have heard about problems on peace and order. And this is perpetrated not only in the waters of Sulu, but even outside of the Sulu Sea. Sulu Sea is so vast a sea. It is, connected. I mean, after the Sulu Sea, after the South China Sea, you have the Sulu Sea, you have the Celebes Sea. So we hope the entrepreneurs, the big business, would invest and bring development to the South, because we feel that it is big business that can provide labor, that can provide employment, that can provide livelihood for our people. So, again, this would still redound to poverty alleviation.
Maybe I can take off from there. Really, it's almost impossible to have an island of prosperity in a sea of poverty. Therefore, nations which are prosperous, it's into their best interest to spread that prosperity to other countries. And in the old days, maybe trade, now more of investment. I participated in a forum last year because in anticipation of the presidency of our present president, there was a glimmer of hope that the conflict that you've had with China would be resolved in one way or the other. It was a meeting that was conducted together with academics from China, academics here in the Philippines, and some in the security and business sector who were also doing research. And one of the interesting things that came out was that, you know, if you look at conflict, there is always conflict all over the world, territorial conflict in some cases and so on. However, there are also opportunities always. We see opportunities in Sulu, we see opportunities all over the place. And there is one model that is worth looking at. It is a model that says, yes, we disagree on this particular issue, but why don't we put that issue on the side to allow us to collaborate on other issues? In other words, in terms of even territorial disputes and so on, it is seen that this should not in any way hamper the ability of countries to trade and invest. And sometimes even the disputed areas can actually be invested in when the two parties will say, let's put aside the issue of sovereignty, let's just say there are resources that can be exploited for the benefit of both countries. I teach, I'm the dean incidentally of the Centro Escolar University School of Accountancy and Management. And one of the things we discuss with our students is that nowadays when you're talking about business, it's not anymore dog fight dog kind of business. Actually, it's the very strong issue now in business is how do you collaborate with each other? He may be your business competitor, but at some level, you will find opportunities to collaborate so that both of you will have a win-win situation. So maybe that is the kind of model that we're looking at the future. A model which says, yes, we can disagree on certain matters, but that disagreement should not prevent us from moving forward as a team to collaborate in other issues for our own benefit. And who knows, our experience in that kind of collaboration could allow us later to resolve the conflict in some other areas. But as I said earlier, you have come out with a very provocative question, and maybe we can ask some of the people in the audience if they would like to share their own views on this matter, on what are the models that we can have where there are conflict, but there are also opportunities. We have a gentleman way back there. Can you please come forward and just state your name and very concisely, please present your point of view. There's one there on the left.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum to all. My name is Abraham Sakili. I'm a professor of humanities at the University of the Philippines, and I'm from Sulu, Tausug myself. I'm going to present a model. Hopefully, this model can bring about the different perspectives that have been at loggerheads with one another. I've been teaching development. We started all these different models of development, such as the system model, the anti-system model, so-called dependency model. And incidentally, a lot of the so-called models have been proven to be ineffective in dealing with a particular contextual problem. I'm specifically referring to the problems that we face in Holosulu, from which I come from, or in the larger context of the Philippines that has been facing the so-called Moro problem in the Philippines. Now, this model, if this could be understood and then implemented right, then this could once and for all put an end to the multi-level and a multi-dimensional system problem in the Philippines. So structurally, then the governor, former governor of Sulu, has already pointed the importance of restructuring the basis of relationship from the ineffective, highly unitary system of governance of the Philippines since the Malolo system until now, which has been proven to be not really responding to the problem in Mindanao. So federalism is the only doable solution to the Mindanao problem in Southern Philippines, because this will, or this is the only structural mechanism that would strengthen the system of the Muslims that in the Southern Philippines that have for long been a victim of this problem. Now, there are other problems, but I don't have the sufficient time. Unless given the sufficient time, then I could be exposing all this model, but I could be presenting this book that I've written to the organizer. My thoughts are already here. And this is my donation to the
Well, thank you very much. Let's give him a big round of applause. As he has rightly pointed out, while we are meeting here this afternoon, it doesn't mean that our exchange stops today. As we go back to our respective areas, the network that we have established will have the ability for us to communicate with each other and continue the dialogue. And therefore, at this point, I know there's another session coming. Please join me in thanking our presenters for the very enlightening thoughts they have shared, as well as those in the audience who have kindly given us their own perspectives. Thank you.